Directors is called order. Will you please rise and join me for the pledge of allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, liberty, and justice for all.
We seem to have our wires crossed with our student government associates. We won't have their report this evening. Next item of business is request to address the board. I have one, Mr. John Donches.
Hello, John Donches, the mayor. Wanted to address the board as far as the drug forum that was just held the other week. I thought it was very interesting. It was eye-opening to me as somebody that's not even connected with that world. And it was quite amazing, actually, to see all the hands that went up when they asked how many people were on certain medications that were like opioid derivatives, I guess. And I don't know how many people were there. I'm going to guess maybe 200 or so. And I'd say at least 98% of the people raised their hands. It was stunning. Again, to me, eye-opening. And the presentation by everybody on the panel was very good. Again, eye-opening and enlightening with the coroner and everything giving statistics as far as numbers of things. I did record it. I don't know if it's recorded by anybody else. Put it up on the net or whatever. People want to see it. I would even recommend showing that to anybody and their families and their kids. It was quite amazing. The unfortunate part is a couple of their mothers that were there and had their children that are addicts too that were from this school. Not specifically, that's just this school, but this school's included in on it. And I know somebody that knows three kids that went to this high school that died of overdoses last year. And another person that I went to other things and happened to mention this, and they also know people that have had overdoses. And again, part of the concern is they can buy this stuff right in our own cafeteria. Again, not maybe just the only place, school they can do it, but you know, a lot of the mothers, quite a few of them said their children pick the stuff up right here in school. And it leads me to think that safety is the biggest thing that we can do in this school for the children to help in any way possible. You know, we talk about guns and you know, bullets still on an aisle and people go berserk, schools closed down. I don't know if anybody was ever killed by a gun in this school. But I know a couple kids that I've heard that have died of overdoses that went to the school. So if you want to pick on something that you should do, forget that SRO officer. Get a drug sniffing dog and let them loose in here to live and clean it up. Because we can't have this kind of a thing going on. If we can sue gun manufacturers because somebody somewhere bought a gun, shot somebody because he's some kind of a nut, then maybe we could make superintendents, principals, and everything responsible for that too here when somebody gets a drug overdose. That may be the next potential thing that happens. Think about it. You're supposed to provide the safety for the children right here, and if they can't get it, somebody's responsible. And if they get it right here in this school, it's the school. So I'd suggest you take care of that stuff. And then as far as, I see there's a policy even on it that's up for presentation today, maybe first reading or something. I was going through the notes. Get that Narcan or whatever it is, heroin stuff, and let anybody use it. The police even said that you can go to any drugstore and get it without a prescription, anybody, because it's an epidemic. Not only here, everywhere, I guess. Again, it's totally eye-opening to me. Stunning information. So I would change that policy to say anybody, not just nurses and stuff like that, in the school. And just getting back to budget stuff, I hope somebody asks where. Most, if not all, of the money that's going to be raised with the tax increase is going. I'd be very interested to find that out. Considering the last one, it was the pensions. I think we might even bump some money from fund balance to make up what we didn't have by the tax increase last time. I'd like to know what it is this time. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Donches. I have another request to address the board, so I'll entertain an approval of bets. Thank you, Dr. Parker. Any discussion on the motion? All in favor of approving the minutes signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have a presentation.
Thank you. Good evening, everybody. Since I've been in the district, we've had a few conversations at the board level regarding full-day kindergarten, and I'm sure that before I was in the district, there were other conversations about the possibility of full-day kindergarten. What we'd like to do tonight is present a proposed timeline to move this beyond occasional conversation and move this into an actual plan for the possible implementation. And our assistant superintendent, Kristen Campbell, is going to present that to you before that in public on a proposed timeline to study this issue.
In September 2003, quite a few years ago, East Penn began offering its first full-day kindergarten option at Lincoln Elementary School. And this program primarily served students who demonstrated a need for full-day kindergarten, particularly in our Lincoln and Jefferson sending areas. So again, that's back in 2003. 4 years later, in September 2007, East Penn offered a second full-day kindergarten program at Lower McKenzie Elementary School. For those of you who were perhaps on the board at the time or even as community members, you might recall that Lower McKenzie Elementary School for a period of time housed our kindergarten classrooms from four of our elementary schools at the time. And so in 2007, we opened again a second full-day kindergarten program at Lower McKenzie Elementary School. As you also likely know, Lower McKenzie Elementary School closed in 2010. And at that point, that second full-day kindergarten program no longer existed. However, the following school year, 2010-11, we took what was once that second full-day kindergarten program and we opened up that program at Albertus Elementary School. And so that full-day kindergarten program is still in existence at Albertus and serves students from Albertus, McKenzie, Shoemaker, West Coastville, and Willow. So as it stands right now, for well over about 10 years, we've had at least one full-day program, and since 2007, a second full-day program that we've offered in East Penn. Full-day kindergarten is a program that we as an administrative team feel has tremendous benefit to our youngest population of learners in the district. And tonight I'm sharing with the board a proposed timeline for the potential implementation a full-day kindergarten program in East Penn for the 2018-19 school year. And again, I want to emphasize for both the board and our community that this timeline is based on a potential implementation of full-day kindergarten in 2018-19 school year. And the timeline includes two solid years of research, particularly in 2016-17, and then a second year of planning for full-day kindergarten. I will go through some details of the 2016-17 year and the 2017-18 year with you this evening, and you will see that our research and planning process also includes regular communication and checkpoints with the school board and the community, and again, I will highlight those checkpoints with you this evening. If we start first with the current school year, 2015-16, this evening we are sharing with you that proposed timeline, which includes two full years of researching and planning for full-day kindergarten. And next month, May 2016, our next step in the planning process, or I should say in the research process, would then be to identify a full-day kindergarten committee. And that would be a small group of individuals. Likely we're looking for representation from administrators, teachers, a parent representative, or parent representatives. And that group will again carry out the bulk of the research that will begin next school year, particularly in July through December 2016. That community, that full-day kindergarten group, or that committee that we discussed, will actually work as a team to research full-day kindergarten. Particularly, we will look at the characteristics of effective kindergarten programs, the criteria that that research have shown have a positive influence on our youngest population of learners, the benefits of full-day kindergarten versus a traditional half-day program. Part of our research will also include looking at other districts, and there are many in our area as well as across the state that offer full-day. And again, I think we have the added and unique benefit in East Penn of the fact that we've had a program at Lincoln that's been in existence since 2003, and a program that's been in existence since 2010 in Alberta. So we can look at data in terms of the impact of our own in-house full-day program on our students. We will also have an opportunity to do some teacher and parent survey in terms of the perspectives for the need of full-day kindergarten. Upon doing that research for a period of about 6 months, you can see, and it's highlighted for you there, in January of 2017, our full-day kindergarten committee will come back to the board and present our research to you. And it would also be, not at that very meeting, but at the next meeting in January, that the board would then vote on a decision, make a decision as to whether or not we move ahead with the next step of implementing full-day kindergarten, which goes from the research phase. We're actually looking for direction then at that point as to the ability to move ahead with planning for full-day kindergarten. So that's one of those key checkpoints, again, that includes both a presentation of the research as well as at that next meeting then a decision or looking for direction from the school board. Assuming that the board votes affirmatively or approves the decision to move ahead with full-day kindergarten planning in East Penn, the spring of 2016-17 would then really move from the research phase to the planning phase. And that would include small groups of teams looking at curriculum and instruction, technology resources, facilities, space in our buildings, classrooms. And as you know, we've done some preliminary review of our facilities as they are now. Human resources in terms of staffing, transportation, those are all just a few of the key distinct pieces that we would need to consider in terms of planning for full-day kindergarten implementation. And again, that's happening primarily during the spring of 2017. And that planning then continues in full force for the 2017-18 school year. That planning will then begin to we will begin to develop and finalize costs and expenses. So once we know exact staffing needs, once we know exact curricular instructional resource needs, once we know exact transportation needs, we can then begin to pinpoint costs with those needs. So in November 2017, again, we will share costs with the board so that in December of 2017, the board would then vote on full-day kindergarten program implementation for the 2018-19 school year, which is really what we consider to be the second pivotal checkpoint in terms of the school board having an opportunity to hear information, ask questions, and then ultimately make a decision and give a recommendation to move forward. Again, pending approval of program implementation for the 2018-19 school year, the spring of 2018 would really be a continuation of planning for implementation of full-day kindergarten in East Penn for the following school year. So what that would look like in the spring of 2018, we anticipate that early spring, late winter of 2018, we would reach out to our current elementary staff and determine if there are interests of teachers who would like to teach full-day kindergarten so that we can begin to plan some professional development opportunities in terms of curriculum and instructional shifts that might happen for those full-day kindergarten teachers. It would also allow us to continue professional development for all of our primary staffs, because when we talk about a full-day kindergarten curriculum, there may certainly be some natural curriculum and instructional shifts that may happen perhaps in our first grade classrooms as well. The other pivotal piece in the spring of 2018 would be, as you know, East Penn has traditionally had its kindergarten registration at that time. And therefore, once we know for sure or for a fact if we will be offering full-day kindergarten in the 2018-19 school year, those March 2018 kindergarten registration numbers will really be of utmost importance to us in terms of being able to plan for sure the number of full-day kindergarten teachers we will need for that following school year. And that would then allow us in late spring, April and May 2018, to really finalize our recruitment for full-day kindergarten teachers. Again, with the ultimate potential goal, August 2018 would then be the implementation of full-day kindergarten in all East Penn Elementary schools. So again, the purpose of this evening really was to share with the board and the community an overview of the timeline that we have in terms of one full year of planning with regular communication and checkpoints with the board, ultimately with the board's approval, then aiming for a 2018-19 implementation. I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have at this early stage in the planning process.
Thank you, Mrs. Campbell. Any questions for Mrs. Campbell?
So first of all, I want to thank you for this timeline. I really appreciate the way you and your staff have put in the work to make to show the community on this board ahead of time sort of how this is going to unfold, rather than just sort of presenting it in full cloth. I also appreciate the many places you have in here for various stakeholders to provide input on what's best for this particular community for all day kindergarten. So, mostly what I want to say is thank you for this. I'm excited about the possibility of all day kindergarten in the district. My question is, I know now you've spent some time on this. This timeline includes, various places where research is going to be done, but you've already spent some time on this. Outside of cost, what do you anticipate the largest obstacle to successful implementation of a program like this to be?
I think you're right that costs are one of the largest. I think the other piece when we do our research is really focusing on the criteria of what makes a full-day kindergarten program successful. Because it really is, and you're right, in doing some preliminary research, what we know from research is that it's not just about having our 5 and 6-year-olds here for a full school day, but instead it's really looking at the types of learning activities in which they're engaged. And so I think that's really a critical piece, that from the very beginning, we as a committee identify what will full-day kindergarten in East Penn look like. And again, I think that's also very critical when we bring our first presentation to the board in terms of being able to articulate or almost paint a picture for you of how we see a full-day kindergarten program looking different from a traditional half-day program.
I don't know a whole lot about this, but I do know that Pennsylvania is one of the few states that doesn't actually mandate all-day kindergarten. So nationally, we're sort of behind the curve on this. But given that it's not mandated in Pennsylvania, does that free us from some of the state-mandated curricular requirements for kindergarten? I mean, that is, does this district and this community have a freer hand in developing something that will be useful for our district? Or does it, once we institute it, does it sort of fall in under this, are there the same level of sort of dictates as there would be at the, at the elementary level?
If there still are, we still look to state standards in terms of developing a curriculum for kindergarten. I think the difference now is the depth and breadth at which we can, and the types of learning activities that we can expose our kindergartners to in a half-day program versus if we had them for about 5 to 6 hours of instruction. So it's not that we would expect a different set of standards.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Mr. Champagne.
Again, I'd like to thank you as well for this effort. One question I have is, since you've been running on a limited basis for over 10 years now, at different schools. Is part of the research or part of the information that's going to be kind of provided to both the community and the board what you've already learned and what the lessons are that you would implement in the new program if you were to go forward, so that we can really understand what benefits we're going to see if we go district-wide with this? Because you have 10 years worth of data now, 10 years of kind of going through this.
Absolutely, and I appreciate you highlighting that. And yes, when we talk about research, again, there's research that our committee can do, but I think there's also the practical research, the action research that we can conduct in terms of looking at the full-day programs we've had in our district and the impact based on assessment information that we have, based on feedback that we have from teachers, feedback that we have from parents regarding how that full-day program has impacted those students. And you're right, we can absolutely track them through their elementary careers, those full-day students versus their peers who are in the traditional half-day program.
It would be interesting to see how those students have progressed and where, you know, if this has really made a difference, you know, in their education experience.
Right.
Thank you.
Any other comments, Dr. Barker? Do you anticipate, or does the research show different levels of impact based on how ready kids are? I have for starting school, I can imagine it might have a much larger impact on students that are not maybe quite prepared compared to some that have a lot of, you know, are read to a lot and have a lot of other preparation.
Absolutely, and that would certainly be something that we can be attuned to when we're doing our research. But you're correct that the research does show that perhaps there might be, the gains might vary in students who have not attended a pre-K or a preschool program as opposed to those who have been in some sort of formal preschool program. And those would be some of the criteria that we would consider as well.
Mr. Johnson.
Thank you for your presentation. Me being kind of old school, my wife and I gave up a lot to having an at-home mom with our kids when they were growing up. And full-day kindergarten is not something that I'm quick to jump into, but I'm open-minded. But I notice here, it looks like you're going to progress and proceed and looking for the school board vote. And one thing that Mr. Ballard had mentioned, and I don't agree with him often, but I'm going to agree with him on this one, that it should be a referendum for the voters. And I was wondering if that is still a possibility, if that would be on the table for this program when the time comes.
Well, let me answer that, since that's a board question rather than a superintendency question. Since the board is the one who approves it, the board could absolutely decide in that December 2017 timeframe, the board could decide we are not willing to make that decision and put it on the ballot on that May primary 2017. There would be ample timeline to. I think those have to be submitted by sometime in March to get it on the ballot for May. So we would have plenty of time to do so if the board chose.
Thank you. Sorry, I put you in that position.
No, thank you.
Other comments or questions? Ms. Sell.
Recently, we've had the ESSA bill passed, the Every Student Succeeds Act, and Pennsylvania is starting work groups to work on the curriculum and how things should be handled within the state, and I think that work has to be done by August. So there will be lots of things that will be changing, and that's one thing that I presume you'll have to look into to see how to handle a lot of that with whatever the standards are that are changed. But this law on the surface looks like the states have gotten much of their control back. And if you look into the detail, the state will have to send whatever they put together to the federal government to get it okayed, and then it gets sent back if it's approved. So we'll have to see what that is, and it'll be important to see what the kindergarten or a full-day kindergarten looks like from the perspective of them. Now, I, like Dr. Munson here, I'd really like to have carte blanche to do what we know these children would do best with, but I don't think that's the case, or will be in the couple of years that you'll be looking into this, but that's something I think that's you know, here. So
thank you.
Thank you for your work.
Any other questions or comments? Yeah, I had a few. First of all, thank you for the presentation. I do appreciate it. Right now, I'm guessing that we have different numbers of classrooms available in different elementary school buildings. We can't know, of course, how things are going to shake out over the next 2 years, but I think it would be likely that we would have to go through a complete elementary redistricting in order to implement full-day kindergarten. We'd probably have to look at all the sending areas and potentially make adjustments in order to accommodate the extra classrooms. Is that a fair statement, Dr. Schiller?
It's certainly something that we'll study, but if you're asking me, could we start full-day kindergarten tomorrow? We actually could. We actually would have the room.
We have enough room in each of our buildings?
We do.
Wow.
We do, and we've done that thorough study to the point of actually walking the buildings and looking at the rooms. It means some displacement of some, not programs, not necessarily classrooms, but we have, for instance, we might have a full room that's occupied by somebody who needs really just a small group area. So there would be some switching, but we've looked into that. That actually could be accommodated. Now, I don't want to be so quick to say that that's going to be the same conclusion we had a year from now or 2 years from now. There could be more, we have to look at population trends. We do have to account for the fact that once you offer a full day program, you will have people who are currently putting their children in full day private kindergartens who will not say, oh, we're going to put them in East Penn. So we have to factor that in. And once we do that, my answer may change a little bit. But I'm just saying with current numbers, current room availability, we actually would be able to do it.
So we wouldn't have to move any music programs onto a car or on a car room?
No.
Well, that's great, because we did have to do that at one point. Okay, the next question I had was related to the increase in kindergarten registrations. There are many families, because of either their academic preference or maybe their child is not quite old enough to meet our deadline and miss it by a week, but a private kindergarten will take them. If the child then successfully completes a private kindergarten, we then enroll them in the first grade, even though they wouldn't ordinarily have met our timelines and our deadlines for that. We have others who, for child care purposes, put their children in a full day kindergarten. So we have no real easy way to quantify that. We can look at first grade enrollments versus prior year kindergarten enrollments. That'll give us probably a pretty good ballpark estimate, but we won't know for sure until they come in. My mother was actually a kindergarten teacher for the last part of her career, and she said she had a program where the children could fill out a reading chart, and for so many minutes of reading a night, they would check a box. And when they checked off a certain number of boxes on a form, they could bring it in and trade it in for a prize. And after they traded in a certain number of sheets, they got to go to the second tier prize box, and then to the third tier prize box. And she said there were some students who almost every week were bringing in a completed form that their parents or another adult had read with them. And there were some who turned in one or not even any during the whole course of the school year. And she said there was no variation. The children who were read to consistently in the home were far above their peers, and the ones who never got read to were always at the bottom of the class. So I always think that we have to partner with the families to make any kind of a kindergarten program successful. Now this is one teacher's experience that was consistent year after year for about the 10 years that she taught kindergarten. She'd been a second grade teacher and other grades before. And I don't know what the literature says, but certainly we could put in all kinds of wonderful programs. But I would encourage you to look at how do we engage the families and make sure that they're partnering with us to get those kindergarten students off on the best foot possible. And then the other concern I have about the time frame, the board would vote on program implementation in December of 2017. That will be the month that a brand new school board is seated. Four seats will be up for election that time. We, of course, have no idea who's going to run for re-election, who, if anyone, who will end up being elected. I know when I was first running for the board, I tried to attend every meeting that I could in the audience so I could see what the board was working on.
but if we have some candidates who maybe aren't quite so devoted to educating themselves beforehand, to be brought in their first full board meeting after being sworn in and being asked to make a potentially $1.5 to $2.5 million per year decision with far-ranging implications, that might be unrealistic. So just something
great. Thank you.
A very good point. Yeah. I hadn't thought about that. We hadn't discussed that. Would you recommend then, Mr. Earnshaw, that we try to make that earlier, between November or even October?
Well, there are two sides of the coin.
Yes, there are.
Because the outgoing board makes a decision that the new board is then stuck with, or we wait until a certain period of time for the new board is seated so they have time to assimilate the information and understand all the presentations, all the research that's been done, that we'll have the benefit of seeing over the next 2 years that they won't necessarily have been privy to. In fact, probably the people who will be running for the board don't even know they're going to run for the board in some cases. So they're not going to be here at these meetings to try to absorb that information. So I think it's you've got pluses and minuses both sides, and I'll defer it to Dr. Shoulders to see how he wants to handle that.
Yeah, I will definitely take a look at that.
Excellent. Thank you. Any other questions or comments, Ms. Allen?
I just had something that's not to the research stage yet, but you're in that position with kindergarten now as the age cutoffs to accept children. Would you expect that to stay the same as we have it now for the full day first grade?
I believe that will actually be discussed as part of a policy.
Okay. That's on our agenda tonight.
Yes.
It's one of our policies.
Great segue.
No, we're not ready for policy. Brace yourself. He's got it.
One last question. On your previous experience with Lincoln and Jefferson and Lower Cunji, all those years, do you have any kind of demographics on as far as total number of kids that attended full day versus the total number that could have? You know what we're getting at? I'm trying to look at how many people actually took the opportunity versus.
I want to be sure that I'm answering your question accurately. So we can certainly include some of that demographic information when we actually present the research. But what I can share with you in an informal way is typically the class sizes of our full day kindergarten programs are at or around 20. And we oftentimes have waiting lists. Because I believe perhaps what you're getting at is a little bit about the demand or the parent request for it. So, again, I don't want to answer anything incorrectly, but I can share with you that we typically have waiting lists for those for that full day kindergarten classroom.
And when we had one kindergarten class, full day kindergarten class, if I'm remembering right, we had about 17 classrooms for kindergarten, and they had both AM and PM sessions, so we had about 33 kindergarten classes running, and I don't know what we're at today, if it's up or down from there. So one out of 33 or so, about 3% of our students are getting a full day kindergarten.
Small comparison, she's saying.
What she's saying is that
there was high demand.
We had a limit on what was available, capacity, and there was more demand than capacity.
Correct. There was typically a waiting list.
But since we only offered one class and then two classes currently, but there are about over a little over 30 total kindergarten classes. So now we're probably serving 6-7% of our kindergarten students. Doesn't mean that more don't want to be there, but that's
right.
Going to be actually there. Any other questions or comments? All right, thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right, next we have the report of the superintendent, Dr. Schultz.
Yes, thank you. First thing I'd like to report on is that there has been some restored funding for the 15-16 school year as a result of House Bill 1589. We received additional funding in basic ed, ready to learn, special ed. We were originally anticipating, or we had budgeted that or anticipated during our 15-16 budget that we would be receiving roughly $14.6 million. As a result of House Bill 1589, that number is 14.9, and the difference is exactly $296,012. That is the increase in money that we will be receiving this current year. So that's good news as a result of House Bill 1589. Next topic is the discussions regarding the possible closing of Seven Generations Middle School. As I shared with the board and the public, we were scheduled to meet with representatives from Seven Generations on April 12th. That meeting did, in fact, take place. It was a good meeting. It was a long meeting, and there were quite a few questions that we had and a lot of the good information provided to us by Seven Generations. The we was Dr. Torma, Mrs. Campbell, Eric, and myself, meeting with Principal Paul Hunter, CNI Director Jen Hirsch. Seven Generations will be making a presentation to the board at our May 9th public meeting. At that point, you will hear directly from them, citing reasons for their request to amend the charter and suspend operation of the middle school. The board will then be asked to act on that motion either way at the May 23rd meeting. So that's the timeline, and that's the process we have set up.
Dr. Shilke, does that need to be a public hearing to amend their charter? I know we've had to have public hearings in the past to approve their charter.
That is not my understanding that it needs to be an actual public hearing. Mr. Fisher, I believe we checked on that, and we didn't, but if we find otherwise, we'll make a public hearing. Some items here regarding student and staff recognition. Student recognition, actually, the sticker, the wonderful newspaper we have at the high school, which I seem to mention very often because it is such high quality. I wanted to let everybody know that we have five high school students who won the Pennsylvania Press Club Award, and two of them captured first place, which means they will represent the state at the Nationals in Kansas in September. Colleen Bradlett won first place for a news story on her work on the so-called bullets episode at the high school, and an honorable mention for a feature story on her piece as well for Abby Zukowski, fifth grader who passed away last year in Jefferson School. Angeline Stein won first place for a series on cartooning and second place for her Star Wars layout. Abby Moore took third for sports story for a piece on football player Kyle Boney, and Katie Mest earned an honorable mention for a sports story for a profile on girls basketball coach Carl Scheitrin. So the Stinger participants continue to make us proud and represent us well in state and national competitions. The high school math team in February of this year, three teams from the PA Math League represented Emmaus High School at TSA Teams Engineering Competition. That stands for Test of Engineering Aptitude in Mathematics and Science. The contest included problem solving and writing essays, hands-on design. Three teams from Emmaus placed 9th, 12th, and 13th among 84 Pennsylvania schools, so we had a good showing there. And our top team of seniors had the highest score in Pennsylvania, nationally ranked 8th place among 650 schools in the United States. Congratulations go to Vishnu Oster, Jacob Gilbert, Zong He, Samir Lau, Murphy Pan, Darsh Patel, and Ying Zen. On to the high school Future Business Leaders of America group. 18 of those students attended the FBLA conference in Hershey. The Emmaus High School team had a record year. They came home with five top finishers, three of whom qualified to compete at the national level in June. This is the most national qualifiers we've ever had. Scott Heckman, 8th place in intro to business. Justin Howard, 4th place in personal finance. Zong Lau, 1st place in graphic design. Zach Pearson, 10th place in insurance and risk management. Jerry Schlechter, 4th place in business law. And then our spring sports scholar athletes, I always like to highlight scholar athletes, the importance of being an athlete, but the importance of also being a scholar and keeping your grades up and maintaining both, I think is commendable. Following students have been selected as our spring sports scholar athletes. Nicholas Mazzella for baseball, Christian Schaefer, boys lacrosse, Greg Sullivan, girls lacrosse, Miranda O'Donnell, softball, Matthew Fitzmaurice, boys pass, Jacob Firetech, boys track, Catherine Bacher, girls track, Mitchell Sturkenberg, boys volleyball. Congratulations to all of them. Also, Katie Bacher was selected as East Penn Conference Scholar Athlete in girls track. And finally, for student recognition, for LCTI, we have four students here from Manassas High School who attended LCTI who were placed in the Skills USA State Competition. First of all, we have Jeffrey Pennecoff for building maintenance. First place, we have Alaki Atkinson for web design. First place, Kenny Pavlik, graphic communications. Second place, Howard Moyer, heavy equipment operations. Third place. So congratulations to them. Oh, by the way, Jeffrey Pennecoff and Malaki Atkinson are advancing to the national competition on the Louisville, Kentucky in June. Finally, I would like to read a prepared statement regarding the Drug Awareness Community Forum that was held last week at Manassas High School. On April 20th, 2016, the East Penn School District hosted a community forum on drug awareness, which concentrated on the heroin epidemic seen across the nation, across the state, and across the Lehigh Valley. Panelists consisted of law enforcement, paramedics, district attorney's office representatives, local health care providers, county coroner, and parents who have experienced addiction within their own families, and some who have lost a child to heroin. The presentations were extremely informative and at times highly emotional. We must listen to the voices we heard on Wednesday night. The alarming statistics presented are real, and the tragic stories we heard are real. Voices on Wednesday had no political agenda, no ulterior motive to place blame on law enforcement or the medical profession or the East Penn community or the school district. Instead, it was the overwhelming plea for us all to band together and fight this problem as a community. The school district has drug education programs and resources in place, but as long as lives are still being lost to drug addiction, we must and we will do more. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Schiller. Any questions or comments for Dr. Schiller's report, Mr. Bethel?
Yeah, I have some questions on the things to do with the budget. I understand where House Bill 1859 is getting some of the money for some of these things that you want. One of the things that I've been questioning is the SRO and the monies that go to that, and I've been doing a lot of research on it.
Mr. Nautelli, we don't have on our agenda tonight to discuss the coming year's agenda or positions that might be part of it. So we'd ask you not to, and since it was not part of Dr. Schiller's report, what he talked about was the extra state money that we received for the current year's budget, not next year.
Okay.
So we'll definitely be talking about the SRO. I'm sure you're not the only one who will have strong opinions one way or the other on it. Well, but they'll be strong, right? I'm sure they will. So I'd ask you not, since no one is prepared to discuss that tonight, can you hold that, I think, for our next board meeting?
Our next board meeting will, I mean, okay. Our new business administrator is starting next Monday. We have been keeping him apprised of all the information that's been shared with the board and the public. So far, he has that information. I've had an opportunity to talk with him. And hopefully we'll be ready to start that discussion at the next board meeting, which is May 9th. And continuing through the second board meeting as well.
Did you have any other questions?
I just wanted to say I was among the board members and public who attended Wednesday night's session. It was powerful, it was eye-opening, and I thank you, Dr. Schilder, for making our facility available for such an important event. I'm guessing there were about 300 people there. It was a good number of people, but we need to get the message out even more strongly. My sense was that many of the people in the audience were already personally familiar with the drug problem. And we need to bring people in who haven't had the personal contact yet so that we can prevent it from happening.
Thank you. Ms. Flora, any other comments or questions? Thank you. Next, we have item 7, personnel. I'd like to invite a motion on items A through K, please.
So moved.
Second. Any discussion on those items A through K? Ms. Allen?
Jay, I was just wondering, what is the definition of a guest teacher? It says substitutes. Are they from the colleges, or what are they?
I'm sorry, I'm in the middle of passing something out, so tell me
page again. 3 at the top.
Yes.
Where?
Per diem substitutes. Guest teacher. There are 4 of them listed there.
Jessica, would you mind answering that? Because I know I've asked you that question before. Before I speak, I don't want to make sure I'm being accurate.
They go through training.
This is Jessica Hoffelbach, our HR manager.
They go through a training at the IU, and they receive a certificate. They also are approved through PDE for that year and the following year to be they have an emergency permit to teach, so they're substitutes.
So it's a regular classroom teacher, that they're allowed to be in the regular classroom?
Correct, as a substitute.
Not just support services, but classroom.
Right, as a classroom teacher.
Thank you, Jessica. Okay, any other questions or comments?
Well, I just had a follow-up on that. So is the idea of these emergency certificates that there's a shortage of fully diploma teachers?
Certificated teachers.
The IU actually hosts this guest teacher program every fall, and this year was the first time that they offered it in the spring because of the shortage.
Okay. Thank you.
I think it's a fantastic opportunity for people to try the profession before they get fully into it. I heard that teaching has one of the highest turnovers of new teachers, so some people go into it and find it wasn't quite what they were expecting. Any other discussion on the motion? Ms. Allen, please call the roll.
Ms. Allen?
Aye.
Mr. Champagne?
Aye.
Ms. Fuller?
Aye.
Dr. Munson?
Aye.
Dr. Bacher?
Aye.
Mr. Dontelli?
Aye.
Ms. Earnshaw?
Aye.
7 ayes.
Motion carries. Next, we have item L. A new collective bargaining agreement with the Food Crafters Association. May I please have a motion?
So moved.
Second. Any discussion on the motion? Ms. Allen, please call the roll.
Ms. Fuller?
Aye.
Dr. Munson?
Aye.
Dr. Bacher?
Aye.
Mr. Donatelli?
Aye.
Ms. Allen?
Aye.
Mr. Champagne?
Aye.
Mr. Earnshaw?
Aye.
7 ayes.
Motion carries. Next, we have the appointment of our new treasurer this week. Fill out the current year's term and then to reappoint for the next year. Under state law, we appoint a treasurer for a one-year term. You can't vary the term of office. So this fulfills that requirement. May I have a motion, please? Let's have a motion and then
so moved.
Second.
Okay. Yes, Mr.
I just want to clarify, because I think I asked this before, I just want to make sure this position for Mr. Saul is included in his formal hire we discussed before in that salary.
There's no additional compensation for serving as the foot treasurer.
That's correct.
Okay, any other questions or discussion on the motion, Ms. L?
The year that he's able to be treasurer, is that renewed every year after that then?
Well, it's up to the board.
Okay.
So the under state statute, we can only appoint a treasurer for a one-year term.
So every year we have to either appoint, reappoint him or appoint a new one. Yeah, so that's defined by law. The board secretary is appointed to a four-year term by law. Those are the two.
Any other discussion on the motion? Mrs. Allen, will you please call the roll?
Mr. Donatelli?
Aye.
Ms. Allen?
Aye.
Mr. Champagne?
Aye.
Ms. Fuller?
Aye.
Dr. Munson?
Aye.
Dr. Bacher?
Aye.
Mr. Earnshaw?
Aye.
Seven ayes.
Motion carries. Next, item eight, business operations. Is there any objection to taking all five items together?
Separate A and B.
Into two separate motions, or?
Yes, we have.
May I have a motion on item A, approval of bills, please?
So moved.
Okay, discussion on the motion?
Again, it's all, we get a chance to sit down, Mr. Song, I get more familiar with that, I'm saying.
Any other discussion on the motion? Mrs. Allen, will you please call the roll?
Ms. Allen?
Aye.
Mr. Champagne?
Aye.
Ms. Fuller?
Aye.
Dr. Munson?
Aye.
Dr. Bacher?
Aye.
Mr. Donatelli?
Same.
Mr. Earnshaw?
Aye.
Six ayes.
And one abstention.
One abstention, I'm sorry.
Thank you, motion carries. May I have a motion on item B, the treasurer's report, please?
Second.
Mr. Donatelli, do you?
Yeah, just getting involved with this stuff, I noticed that there's a lot of transfers back and forth, and some of them seem to cancel from one to the other, but also there's.
Are you talking about the budget transfers?
Yes.
This is the treasurer's report that he asked to be held out.
I apologize.
So you're talking about item C or item A?
I'm sorry.
All right, any discussion on the motion B, the treasurer's report? Mrs. Allen, will you please call the roll?
Dr. Munson?
Aye.
Dr. Bacher?
Aye.
Mr. Donatelli?
Aye.
Ms. Allen?
Aye.
Mr. Champagne?
Aye.
Ms. Fuller?
Aye.
Mr. Earnshaw?
Aye.
Seven ayes.
Motion carries. We have a motion on item C, budget transfers.
Second.
Questions, Mr. Donatelli?
All right, the budget transfers, I notice almost half of these are in the athletic department, and just kind of picking up on, is that common that we're so, or is this unusual? I've never noticed this before as we're doing this, and I'm just kind of curious if this is a typical occurrence to deal with these shuffling back and forth.
It's somewhat typical, it's been my experience in this district and other districts, but part of the reason is we needed to cut back that particular program, if you remember those cuts last year. So you're really watching every penny and making transfers in order to keep things balanced. So but yes, I think it is.
Is it safe to assume that I go through the numbers here, this end up being a neutral, it's a zero?
Yeah, it's not a lot of zero balance. Yeah, that's a lot.
That's my only question.
Okay. All right. Any other discussion on the motion? Ms. Allen, will you please call the roll?
Ms. Allen?
Aye.
Mr. Champagne?
Aye.
Ms. Fuller?
Aye.
Dr. Munson?
Aye.
Dr. Bacher?
Aye.
Mr. Donatelli?
Aye.
Mr. Earnshaw?
Aye.
Seven ayes.
Motion carries. Next, I'll take items D and E together. May I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Discussion on the motion?
Excuse me. My apologies. I thought that the comments from the public would be made during the time of the motion, and I had some comments regarding sale of the property. Wondering if I could please make those comments.
Yeah, I'll permit it.
Thank you.
Please come forward. And after your comments, if you would please fill out one of the forms at the back with your name. It's on the table in that corner. That way the board secretary will have your contact information. You can introduce yourself, please.
Okay, my name is Kristen Downey, and I live in Lower County Township,
thank
and
you.
My daughters attend East Penn School District. I wanted to express concern over the sale of this property on Lower McCungie Road, adjacent to the middle school. I'm concerned that the sale of this property was done privately without the public's knowledge.
One, because more than $1 million of taxpayer money was invested into that school less than 10 years ago, and now the district intends to sell this property at a loss. Secondly, the property is adjacent to the current middle school and serves the community with a park, as well as the current aftercare building and the sports field that would all vanish with this sale. And thirdly, it also contributes to the loss of open space in the township, as well as more traffic concerns along Crocs Road in a neighborhood that is already going to have a lot more traffic issues with the building that's going out on the bypass. Additionally, I believe that the public has a right to know if by law this property is actually allowed to be developed for use other than a school, since the property deeds show that the property was part of the Act of Congress known as the Federal Farm Loan Act.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is there any discussion on the motion? Dr. Munson?
Just a point of clarification. My understanding is that this agreement is has already been approved, and that the what we're voting on now is simply a name change of the organization that purchased the property. Is that correct? The contract we're voting on now is, in all other respects, identical to an approval that was already made.
Correct. Any other discussion on the motion? Mrs. Allen, will you please call the roll? This is for items D and E.
Mr. Champagne?
Aye.
Ms. Fuller?
Aye.
Dr. Munson?
Aye.
Dr. Bacher?
Aye.
Mr. Donatelli?
Aye.
Ms. Allen?
Aye.
Mr. Earnshaw?
Aye.
7 ayes.
Motion carries. Next, item 9, curriculum. May I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion on the motion? Mrs. Allen, will you please call the roll?
Dr. Bacher?
Aye.
Mr. Donatelli?
Aye.
Ms. Allen?
Aye.
Mr. Champagne?
Aye.
Ms. Fuller? Dr. Munson?
Aye.
Mr. Earnshaw?
Aye.
7 ayes.
Motion carries. Next, we have our policy review. Buckle your seatbelts, ladies and gentlemen. We have some material error in this. Please do.
I'd like to make just a couple quick opening comments. I did receive items or considerations for suggestions for changes from Dr. Munson, from Mr. Earnshaw, and from Dr. Bacher. I have had a chance to read them. What I have not had a chance to do is actually incorporate those into the documents you see tonight. So it's certainly up to the three of you as to whether you want to go through these, and obviously that's your choice. What we will do with the items that you put forward is we will put them as in, as much as we can, we will incorporate them into the policies, and you'll see those on second reading, to the point that it is approved by the board solicitor, and administratively, we feel, you know, we agree with you. I can see from perusing them that we're probably going to agree the vast majority of them, as we have before. So I just want to point that out. There certainly may be comments from other board members as we go through these. I will have some comments for some of the policies that I actually went through this weekend and then had a conversation with Dr. Forman this morning on some things I'd like to clarify. So that's it. That's my introduction.
Seems like I was not the only one with a little last weekend reading. All right, let's start with policy 200. Do you have a comment on that?
I have no comment on that.
Okay, anyone have any issues about the room, Mr. Blanco?
I have three items on this one. First one, just clarification on the first paragraph there is the administrative regulations. What is administrative regulations? Administrative regulations for any of these policies, you'll see that, you've seen that already. It's basically guidelines that then the administrators and the administration would set up to implement the policy. Often the administrator brings more detail, more of, like I said, how we're going to. Sometimes we have administrative regs already in place. Sometimes they're in other documents. They need to be called out, called administrative regs. And sometimes we don't have the regs at all, which means we have to fill them.
The second, very bottom, the district shall immediately enroll identified homeless students, even if the student or parent guardian is unable to produce the required documents. And qualify as administrator.
Qualify it?
Then I go to tell you so that that should be bringing them in and educating them. That's the law. Okay. I guess I'm curious as to how you determine that the student's homeless, I guess, they go out.
Homeless is actually legally defined under federal law. It would be one of many standards.
I'm familiar with territory police officers.
That's okay. I can't quote you all of them right here, but it's more than you might think. It includes such things as somebody who doesn't have, I think the magic legal words are a fixed abode is one of them. It could be, for example, one you'll be familiar with, people who were displaced as a result of Hurricane Katrina many years ago, immediately qualified as homeless. So there's a number of specific possibilities that will allow somebody to be qualified, and the law does require, the district has no choice. You must educate them if they meet one of those requirements.
Okay, and then I guess the top of the next page, the district shall not inquire about the immigration status of a student as part of the enrollment process. And I think this big thing was obviously going on that, given Donald Trump so many supporters right now, I'm trying to question, is this something that the state has public, or is it something that's...
There is a citation to a Pennsylvania code regulation. We'll double check that for you.
Okay, guys. That's the only questions I have on that.
Okay, any other questions or comments about policy charter, Ms. L?
Back to the bottom of the page with the homeless students. Says, even if they're unable to produce the appropriate documents, what do they do to just come in and say, I'm homeless?
It's almost as simple as that to begin with.
Yeah. And then do you continue to try to find something as to the truth and validity of it, or?
Yeah, there's a process that has to be done.
Just to make sure I understand, under guidelines, eligible non-residents, is that defined in policy 202? Is that where that's defined, or is that a defined term someplace else?
Yes, that's
two or three. Okay.
Any other comments on this policy? All right, 201. Comments on this one?
I have no comments on this one.
I was just going to end my comments. I was just wondering if I understood on the bottom two paragraphs on the first page. It seems like anyone 6 years, is the intent of the policy that anyone 6 years or older can start first grade, and then if they're five, they have a number of things they need to demonstrate in order to start first grade. And although it's not said directly, is it implicitly said that anyone less than five is not eligible to start first grade?
I would say you're correct on those statements you just made.
Okay.
Dr. Toro, would you agree with me on that?
Yes.
What I heard, yes.
Okay. That's what I thought, and that's supposed to, I think it could be made more clear was the, my comments.
Okay, so you're saying this is the last paragraph is for six, under 6 years.
Well, it says five, it doesn't mention four.
But what you're suggesting is that a four-year-old under our policy cannot be admitted to the first grade.
Well, there's, well, my question was in the second paragraph, it says, has attained the age of six or has satisfactorily completed 1 year of enrollment in licensed kindergarten program. Technically, a four-year-old could do that. And then they're not five, so the third paragraph doesn't apply to them. And so, sure. That's what I was just saying. I think if that's the intent, we should make that a little more clear.
Okay. We'll take a look at that.
Okay. Any other comments on policy? Yes.
Just under the first paragraph of the first grade, the last sentence, child is 8 years old, and shall be municipal in that. With respect to just first grade, is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay.
202. Dr. Munson.
Yeah, I just had a question about what, if you could give an example of what a resident of an institution in the district would be. And
this is page 2 near the bottom.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Residents of institutions. I mean, I feel like I'm just trying to get at something rather specific, but like I don't
know. A child who's living in or assigned to a facility or institution can either Dr. Mirabella or Dr. McCarra. Would you be able to give an example? If you can't, please say no. I don't want to put you on the spot.
I can make a hypothetical.
Can you give a real example?
I can give a real example.
Dr. McCarra, go ahead.
We have a group home that is located within the district, and so students could be non-residents and living in that group home, but we are responsible for the education because the group home is located within our community.
Okay, so then sort of a companion question to that is, there's this discussion of paying tuition, and if I read this correctly, the only non-residents that to which tuition would be applicable are precisely these institutionalized children. Is that correct?
Can you repeat that?
Let me phrase it differently. Is there any category of student that
so
is...
I'll answer your question, no. We can permit non-resident students in other circumstances, can at our option, but the residents of institutions, we are required to admit them. But for any other non-resident, the board has the option of whether or not to admit them, I think.
So
if you look under authority at the top of page 2, the board may permit the admission of non-resident students.
In accordance with board policy.
Yes. So they have to meet all the other requirements. So you can't take a non-resident student who doesn't have the proper immunization documentation,
right,
or you know, is too young or too old or any of those other requirements. This allows us to do so. In my term on the board, we have never chosen to do so.
So can you clarify then, maybe I'm misreading this. My initial read had been that institutionalized non-residents must pay tuition.
That's your question is focused on tuition.
Well, I'm changing my mind now. Now I'm wondering if I don't understand the policy.
So as an example, with the Carbondale High Intermediate Unit, we run our emotional support programs, but we have what's called fair share. So in other words, if a student in Parkland needs emotional support, they could contact the district and say, can we use your program? And if we choose to say yes, then we would charge tuition to Parkland for that student to be in our program.
So I'm on page 2 of 3 under guidelines, the clause residents of institutions. It says a child who's living in or assigned to a facility or institution for the care or training of children that is located within this district is not a legal resident of the district by such placement, but he or she shall be admitted to district schools, and a charge shall be made for tuition in accordance with law.
Yeah, so what that's saying is that we have the option as a board to admit any non-resident student who meets all of our other requirements, but we also have the right to not admit them. But for this class of students, we are required to admit them, but we are also allowed to charge them for that purpose.
Okay.
In accordance with law.
Which would be charging back Parkland in your example.
Yes, exactly.
Not the student.
Right.
In the first example you gave of a group home.
Yes.
Do we receive tuition?
We do. We charge.
From the district that they would normally reside in.
Where the parents reside, yes.
So that works.
Okay.
So we have some of our students who are incarcerated in a forestry camp up in the Poconos. We end up paying the cost of their education. And so it would be a very similar situation.
Thank you.
Any other questions, Dr.
Kind of a different thing from Dr. Munson. Am I to understand that a good pupil, as far as another school, maybe now kind of wanted to move out of Allentown, or wanted to come to Emmaus and pay tuition, if the board allowed it to occur, as long as they're willing family tuition that is involved?
Yes, the board has that, always has that option.
The board, as Mr. Earnshaw said, does not do that.
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear your question.
If a student from another school district didn't want to move from their current resident but wanted to go to East Penn because of the caliber of education they would be getting versus where they are now, they wanted to improve the quality of education, could they apply to come here or request to come here if they were willing to pay the tuition and the board allowed it? Is that a possibility?
In theory, the board could approve it, but I don't think it says that. I don't think that's been your practice here in East Penn. And I'm seeing head shaking, know that they agree with me, and I don't think that that's what the policy says either.
But it does give us the authority to do so, but the board has chosen not to exercise that authority.
I would say it's not consistent with our policies. We'd have to change our policy. We have specific cases where we allow, like, former residents that were here in 10th and 11th grade, and they can stay for 12th. But my reading of this and other policies was that nowhere do we allow it.
That's
we
correct.
Say we have the authority to allow it consistent with board policy, but none of our board policies actually allow it. So I think we would have to change board policy to allow that practice.
You have nothing in your policies that follows through with your ability to allow this, so therefore you don't allow it. In fact, calls that I get on this, I respond no. The board, this is not something the board does. It's not in board policy to allow that.
If I may, perhaps to move this matter forward, you can take a look at that. But I believe that there's another policy that deals with the 11th or 12th grade. I think it's in a policy.
It's here.
Yeah,
that's right.
This policy. Yes.
Just to clarify, I know someone who asked maybe a year or two ago, wanted to send their child to East Penn, and they asked the superintendent, and there was no ability to do that with the previous administration either. And my reading of the board policy at that time, there was no, while this policy says we could do that if we choose, I didn't find anything in our policy that actually allows it and provided a mechanism.
There are a lot of issues that we would run into were we to decide to open up our schools. How do you select which students to admit? You can discriminate. You've got anti-recruitment policies of TIAA for athletics. So it would open, and of course, with a high-quality district like East Penn, there would be a lot of people that would potentially want to come here. That's not, we're in business to serve the students who live in the district.
Well, I understand, but I'm sorry, not here like we talked. This was to me was saying we could do this.
We do have statutory authority to do it. We have not implemented a board policy that gives us permission outside of these limited circumstances to do it. But we could. We have the statutory authority. If we added a paragraph to this, or probably two or three pages to this about how we would go about doing that, we could. That would be inadvisable for probably many reasons, including capacity and everything else. Okay, Mr. Chairman?
Just clarification of a question, I guess. Why was the delegation of responsibility deleted? In particular, thinking about the board that doesn't want to be dealing with these matters on a day-to-day basis, I would think that the superintendent should be responsible for implementing this. I'm just curious as to why the delegation's authority was taken out.
Because the policy as it's written is tight. It tightly defines what I can do and what I can't do as a superintendent. Therefore, there's no need for administrative regulations. There's no need for administrative regulations that would pertain to the last discussion we just had on non-resident students being enrolled here, because we don't do that. So basically, we don't do it, and every other category is already defined in the policy. So I don't think you need administrative rights.
I'm more concerned about just making sure the board isn't dealing with these matters, you know, that they're not coming to the board for document review or anything like that. That you are doing that prior to admitting anybody that falls under these categories. And that's why I'm saying, delegation of authority would be the appropriate way to handle that.
I think there's a delegation of authority implied in every policy you have. I don't think that's always necessary to put that in. Because if you keep it in, look at the word.
Well, I'm not suggesting the wording's correct. I'm just saying what I'm saying is that there should be a delegation of authority that makes sure that you implement policy. Doesn't mean I'm looking for administrative regs. I'm wanting to make sure that the board isn't making the decision on which one of these, if all of the documentation is appropriate and so on and so forth for admitting a non-resident.
Okay. I don't think it's necessary, so I disagree with you on that. But if the board feels they would like to put that in, it's fine.
I just wanted to understand how.
Only because every policy there is the assumption that the superintendent is in charge of implementing the policy.
I understand that a lot of these have delegation of authority embedded in them, and so I just see a consistency.
Okay, I hear you.
Some do, some don't. Any other comments on 202? Okay, 203.
All right, I do have a couple of comments on this one to start out with. 203 is immunizations and communicable disease. We've been looking into the last 24 hours, and I know a few board members wrote this up as well. Under guidelines, the PSBA recommendation was using the words, unless specifically exempt for religious or medical reasons. We inserted the word philosophical. The reason we inserted the word philosophical is because the school immunization report, it's a form that we have to fill out. It's a report. Ever since the 2013-14 school year, added a separate category on there called philosophical/strong moral or ethical exemption. So that's why we added the word philosophical. However, in talking a little bit more with PSBA about this, the state regulations only talk about two categories. And those two categories are medical and religious. When we ask, well, where's this philosophical fit in? Their interpretation is that philosophical or moral issues or reasons fit under religion. I don't know if you agree with that or not, but that was their answer. In my opinion, philosophical, just that word itself, is so open-ended that since it's not in their state regs, I would recommend not putting it. Put it in here, I would now recommend taking it out now that I have a little more clarification. It's not in state regs. But of course, we would review that with the board solicitor and make sure that's appropriate. That would be my recommendation on that. On the page 202, second paragraph, monitoring the immunization requirements shall be the responsibility of the superintendent of SME and department chair. Used to say head nurse. We don't have such a thing called head nurse. We do have a nurse who is considered department chair of nurses. So we probably should clarify that by saying, and the department chair for the nurses.
Yes.
Because when people think of department chairs, they think of the social studies chair and the science chair and so forth. That's not what we're talking about. But that is the correct terminology for the district. So I would add that word, those words to that. Further down under where after number three, it says the superintendent or designee shall report immunization data on the required forms to the Department of Health by, we had October, we changed it to March, we looked into that a little bit, and in the past few years, the state has changed that from October 15th to December 15th to March 15th. So what we would recommend is putting some wording in there that basically says in accordance with
the
reports
required.
So that we don't have to worry about the date. If they're going to change it so often, let's not have to change our board policy. And those are all the comments that I have for that policy.
Any other comments, Mr. Bradfield?
Back on page one, if you remove, because one of my questions was on the bottom paragraph, that medical or religious, we didn't have philosophical down there. I would say make sure we're consistent throughout. But I do have a question, and I don't know where this falls, but I look at this myself, my youngest child, one of the immunizations that needs to be given the incident of death kind of outweighed the incident of saving his life, he opted not to do that, and I had a little bit of battle with the school district, and it kind of went away. Where does that fall? Is that medical? Is it statistical? Or is it philosophical? It wasn't religious.
It's not medical unless there's a doctor's note that says there's a medical reason not to give the immunization.
On the desk, statistical analysis said, it's not worth doing this.
It's not religion. I would have to say, and I'm not being flip, I would have to say you would have a battle with the school district, or at least with this policy, because I don't know, I don't see that being covered.
Right.
I can't comment why it went bad, but.
Wait before your time. But he graduated, no question.
The general question I had is, when there was discussion about immunizations, my understanding was state law granted two exemptions, and we probably don't have the authority to add more exemptions to state law. The state law says everyone must be immunized unless they fall under these categories. We can't create another category. So I
correct.
So it's a moot point for us to discuss. It's, if that's not in state law, and state law only allows certain things, then we don't have any choice.
Okay. Any other comments on this policy? This is a big public health debate. We've seen resurgences of in the Lehigh Valley of whooping cough, pertussis, I guess is the official name. There have been instances of measles, German measles, diphtheria, polio. These are scary illnesses, and I think that the debate is going to rage for a while longer yet before anything gets settled. But that may drive additional changes to state law. There have been all kinds of interesting policy ideas put forward, like eliminating the religious exemption and compelling immunization, and other people that want to expand it to parental preference. So we don't know where this law might shake out over the next few years. We may well have to change our policy again.
Yes,
I apologize. Under communicable diseases, under 202, the fourth paragraph is instruction regarding prevention of communicable life-threatening diseases shall be provided by the schools. How frequently is that done? Is it done annually? Is it, you know, when the students first enroll? What's the frequency and what should it be if we don't know?
Is that part of the health and wellness curriculum? My inclination is to say it's part of the health and wellness curriculum. Therefore, I don't have an answer on how frequently that is. But I'll double check.
Well, I would also say the following policy on HIV is very specific. It says every year. On HIV specifically.
Was that what you're asking, Mr. Champagne, in terms of every year versus every other year?
I'm asking, should it be done, or I guess more clarified a little further, should it be done every year? And if it isn't, why not? And, you know, are we bound by state regulations that no one wants to do it? You know, once every 2 years, I just want to make sure if we're going to communicate something, we do it.
I'm guessing that the state reg does not give how often it has to be done. So if the state reg is not, and if that's true, we'll look into that. If that's true, then I wouldn't advocate going further than the state reg by saying it should be done every year. It just says, you know, it becomes, again, part of the curriculum and really is up to the school district. And I understand your argument. You could say, well, that would mean that you folks think it should be done every 6 years. That wouldn't be appropriate. So, but let me look into this a little more.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Any other comments on 202?
No, 203, sorry.
203. All right, let's move on to 203.1. Comments on that one? Dr. Munson?
I had some comments that I submitted, and I'll just wait until the second meeting to see how the administration addresses them. But I had an additional one. Maybe this is for Mr. Fisher. Page 203. Under guidelines and then attendance, the third clause. I see that there's a statutory citation to this clause, but my question is, what if consent
by the words in paragraph?
When in effect is yes.
Yes. Okay. It says that the person to whom an HIV positive diagnosis is disclosed will obtain the consent the parents to share that information. I mean, my question is largely a procedural one. What happens if that consent is not given?
Get back. Probably can't disclose it.
Okay. Well, but then that causes all kinds of problems with the rest of the... This policy does not anticipate not getting consent.
Okay, other comments?
Under prevention education, the first paragraph that says prevention shall be taught at every grade level, is that currently being done? Is that happening with the district?
Hold on, just reading. I don't know the answer to that. I want to say yes, but I'm not going to say yes without checking.
I just want to make sure that we're following through on that.
Hard discussion to have with first graders.
With every grade.
Okay. Any other comments on 203.1? All right, 204.